Hi, this is Sub Focus, and I'm here with Computer Music in my studio in North London. We're going to be talking about my track Solar System, which came out in the middle of last year. I thought this would be a good one to talk about because it's like has a mixture of processes that I would tend to use on tracks that I make. A little bit of vocal recording, a little bit modular, and quite a lot of things like how I make patches on Serum, Massive, etc. How I layer my drums, my master bus, that type of thing. The genesis of this track was probably a bit more interesting than most. I had an email from either my publisher or someone at the record label I'm with, and they said that the producers of the recent Blade Runner reboots, Blade Runner 2049, were seeking outside music from artists, and would I like to pitch for that and just basically send in some music that I might have already or make something bespoke for them, which is pretty much like the perfect sort of pitch you could receive. I mean, that film and its soundtrack, the original Vangelis soundtrack, is super influential in drum and bass and electronic music in general. It's been sampled loads, and sort of delving into the production techniques of that original soundtrack and things like Vangelis' use of the CS80 synthesizer are things that I found like massively inspiring for my own production. So it was a really cool brief, basically, and I started the intro idea to Solar System as a kind of idea that you could, as a sci-fi cue, basically. I started with a sort of bed of sounds from my modular synth, so I made an arpeggio on Mutable Instruments Rings, put that through Valhalla Shimmer on the modular, and then I added a bunch of sounds in within Ableton that I led that up with. That was kind of the genesis of it. Once I'd made the idea, which was a completely different tempo and key, I kind of sat on it for a while. I think I felt like I wasn't sure if it was good enough yet, so I didn't really do anything with it for a while. And then I played it to a friend of mine who stated the obvious, which is you should make that into an intro for a drum and bass tune. That's what I did. One thing to say is I don't know if this is the best example of it, but I normally have like quite a sort of organized way of structuring my projects now. I think especially since I've started working with other people, this really comes in handy. So I've started sort of, I normally kind of stack the elements in order of like what's the most sort of focal point of the track. So I tend to have like vocals at the top, then leads, then chords, then effects, then bass, then drums, or more or less in that order. So it kind of makes the projects easier to come back to. I started this with a bed of sounds from the modular synth that I've got over here. So I'll play you the audio that I recorded from there that sort of started the whole track. Here we go, modular bed. So I basically made this repeating arp using a sequencer and modular synchronized with Ableton via an audio clock. And this is an oscillator called Rings, which is a modular oscillator made by Musical Instruments. And that's put through a Valhalla Shimmer reverb that's on the ZDSP over there. So I had this as a bed. I quite often start tracks with beds from synthesizers because it's kind of fun and vibey to play around with synths, put big reverbs on them or delays and just create sounds that you can then use to sort of as a starting point. So once I had that, I started layering some of the, I think I came up with, either the lead or the bass. I think they kind of came at once. So quite often when I'm trying to sort of come up with melodic ideas, I'll play basically two note parts, because that kind of suggests chords and suggests other things. So I'd probably be playing a bass progression and a lead at the same time and trying to figure out like what that would be. So then I think I added this, which is an emulation of the CS80, which was used a lot on the original Blade Runner soundtrack. This is actually not a particularly well-known plugin, but I really rate it. It's called the ME80. And for me, it's a much closer approximation of a CS80 than any other plugin. I remember when I used to have a studio next to the guys from Nero, and they spent a vast amount of money buying an original CS80. And we were doing some tests between plugins and the original, and this was the one that sort of sounded the closest. So I layered this kind of brassy bass sound, and that kind of went hand in hand with this lead, which is the main intro lead, which has got a huge sidechain on it, I think, which I could take off. So from there I basically added these chords and that created the sort of starting idea. I think it was a completely different speed and a different key. So from that original kind of sci-fi cue idea, it ended up changing quite a lot. So, just going into those sounds a little bit, the lead, this is actually a frozen version of the lead, and I froze this because it's got a huge glide on it, obviously. So when I use really pitch bendy sounds, render them, because you sometimes get weird stuff going on with the glides. This is the original sound, so I'm just gonna solo that. Yeah, so this is the original sound. It's pretty simple. It's basically a unison saw wave from Serum. And it's got loads of portamento on it. Small amount of filtering. It's got a sort of flanger filter, which I think is giving it that slightly metallic sound. Not doing a huge amount, but you can sort of hear this. You can hear it there. There's basically a little bit of sort of comb filtering, flanging happening in the top end of it that kind of makes it slightly more interesting than just a saw wave. And then there's seven voices all spread like this, quite tight actually. And then I've just done a slight top end boost and then put it through Fab Filter Pro R Reverb, which is what's making it sound so big. So you can hear there's quite a long tail. Yeah, so I mean, the other sounds in the intro are probably not as exciting, apart from the sort of modular ARP that we talked about before. I've got the MA80 brassy bass sound, and then I've got a just a sort of much more plain bass underneath that, again with a saw wave on a unison detune. And this is weirdly going through a reverb, then an OTT, then an EQ to low pass it. OTT is something you guys probably come across a lot. It's like a multi-band plugin that works really well to sort of bring up a bit of level on sounds if you sort of use it in a subtle way. So actually I've got it on quite an extreme setting here. I mean, I don't think that's probably the most interesting use of it, but yeah, I'll go into more detail on the plugins for sure. Just in terms of the other layering going on in the bass, so there's also this, which is from Serum as well. It's kind of like a more complex wavetable oscillator, and that's basically just on a sort of eighths LFO, basically just creating like a percussive element to the bass, which I've sort of duplicated that type of sound on a few different sounds in the intro. So there's another sound here, which is another unison saw wave, also using an LFO on a low pass just to create like a percussive low end E sound to go along with the intro bass. So those are all the intro bass layers. There's also this effect sound, which I think is from Splice. And this kind of just like emphasizes the first kind of kick and bass note of the pattern in the intro. I sort of felt it kind of combined quite well with everything else. And I think I sort of tuned it to the key of the song. So the genesis of the track, I had this intro and then I played it to a friend of mine, a guy called Sam, who's actually a documentary director, he's not a music producer, but he kind of sat in for a few sessions during the making of this track. And I sometimes like, have friends around to the studio to play ideas. I think it's really good to involve lots of people around you to kind of get feedback and just kind of, you know, kind of inspires different ideas sometimes. And I was playing him the idea at a different tempo, and he suggested the obvious, which was that I should turn it into an intro for a drum and bass tune of mine, which I hadn't really thought of before. And yeah, got to send a big shout out to Sam because he actually spent a lot of time with me whilst I was in the studio kind of making this track. So talking about the intro, I also added this vocal from a session that I did. Sometimes I'll do, there's sort of two types of vocal sessions I tend to do, either sessions where I'm sort of like co-writing a track with somebody, but on this occasion sometimes I'll just, some singers like to work in the way that you just sort of give them some money for a day or, you know, a session's worth of them singing, and then you sort of have the rights to that. And I think sometimes that can be really good to kind of create, like, I like to sort of create vocals that sound like samples basically to use in my songs. There's a kind of real character you get from sampling old records, but obviously you have to clear those samples if you use them. So I kind of try and sometimes sort of make vocals that sound in the spirit of old house songs, for example, and then resample them to use in my tracks. So that was one of them. Other interesting sounds in the intro, there's this sound I quite liked. This is a super subtle element, but it's like an effect sound that I made using the Morphogene on here, which is a modular sampler. And basically, it's something you could do very easy on Ableton as well. It just it allows you to scrub through a sample. So, and you can sort of create things like, just things like that when uses a layer are quite nice. Basically elements that aren't in time that kind of just feel like they've got a bit of a life of their own sort of thing. So yeah, that's a sort of super subtle sound. There's quite a few pretty subtle things. There's this time stretched fire crackle sound effect that's in the intro as well. Again, it's kind of like a bed that you, it's quite nice sometimes. It's a bit like adding vinyl crackle or something. It's nice to have sometimes a sort of noise element that's not very prominent in the mix to give a bit of vibe. Other intro elements. There are these sort of mini risers. I find to sort of add dynamics in songs, there's a kind of process that I normally go through once I've written a track of adding a lot of very subtle sound effects that give the track a bit more movement. And they tend to be things like reverse crashes, bits of white noise, basically stuff to kind of, to sort of, I don't know, give a bit more movement that you're probably not super aware of as a focal element, but they help to kind of make the sound, song sound more dynamic. There's also this band part kit. With the whole intro of this song, I quite like it when you, especially with breakdowns, something that works quite well I find is having sort of sub elements that sidechain everything. So the most simple example of that would be like a big bass sound that ducks the level of a pad. And I sort of tried to do that with the intro of this track. So I've grouped the entire intro elements as a group, with the exception of a couple of things like the effects, which means that I can sidechain them. Yeah. So I've got that, I believe that band pass kick I just played you is sidechaining the whole intro, which just makes it feel, I don't know, just a cool sound. I quite like that effect. I can sort of make it more extreme here to sort of show you what I mean. But yeah, that's something I sometimes do. It's like a subtle kind of trick, I guess. So I think that has covered off a lot of stuff in the intro. Had a lot of different drops for this track, and it sort of took me a while to basically get something that was sounding as interesting as the intro in the drop. I think the drops always felt a bit cheap after the melodies in the intro. But I sort of eventually arrived on the idea that they ended up using. Just as a quick thing, I basically made a big riser out of the intro lead. So I took this sound, and then I think I just did this in the clip in Ableton. So I basically took one note on it, and then just in the clip envelope here, I just used the transposition, put it on a complex mode, and then did a slow ramp up, which you can see happening here. And it basically kind of almost goes to an octave. I think it would go to an octave, but I've chopped it just before, just to make some space for some of the other build-up elements. And disable my emails. Sorry, guys. Okay. And I've used the pitched up octave version of that here, probably through an LFO tool, which is kind of creating a sort of sidechain E movement, and also something on eighths as well. I spend quite a lot of time messing around with LFO tool on elements, because it kind of allows you to sort of just blend elements in more, especially in the drops when you kind of want drums to be really to take up a lot of the energy in the mix. You sort of want everything else to be working around the drums, and basically quite often what you notice about sidechaining is quite often you don't miss the huge chunks that you're taking out of sounds. As in, like, if the volume's ducking around a kick, it doesn't really matter that much because the kick's sort of taking up most of your attention at that time. So there's a lot of chiseling away at different elements to sort of make the volumes of everything sort of sit around the main elements, and basically just like allow you to make the main elements really loud and punchy. Let's move on to looking at the bass, because I think that's obviously the main element in this section. So I think I've got like two sort of main groups of bass. A lot of these are sort of mid-bass sounds. I kind of ended up with tons of layers from previous drops, basically. So there's sort of like lots of different bits and bobs here. But basically the idea centers around this bass sound, which is, there's an old DJ Hazard tune called Busted. DJ Hazard's like a drum bass producer, sort of with real cult status, made some amazing tunes over the years. This, I kind of really wanted to make a sound very similar to this old tune that he did. And I was playing around with Massive and sort of trying to get there. So, just. I was sort of trying to figure out what he did. I think I ended up. So basically, I think the sort of sonic signature of this sound is that it has a very subtle sort of pitch bend in it. But I spent quite a long time trying to recreate. And it's also got some notch filtering and bandpass movement on it, which kind of creates the sound as well. So if you take those off, it's very straight. Then you put these on, it's got a kind of up and down sort of movement to it. So I've basically used these performance LFOs to do the pitch bend, which is just plus 12, and also these performance LFOs to do the filter movement. And then I've got this one doing a volume curve just so that it's just a sort of solo sound rather than it sustaining. Reason for that, I think, is that the sort of the way the pitch bend works, you don't want to hear like the end of it sort of thing. Like if I make this louder. Yeah, actually, I need to take the filter off as well, so it'd be like this. But basically you just don't want to hear the end of the pitch bend. So something like this. A bit longer actually, so it was like this. Once I'd got this, once I had this sound going, I sort of put it through a bit of a chain, so it's going through this, I don't know why I used that, this waves compressor, I think just to get a bit more level. Then a touch of saturation, again, probably just to get a bit more level and attitude. It's got a bit of this Dim D plugin, which is like an emulation of an old Roland, famous old Roland chorus, which is very subtle on it. It's not doing an awful lot. I've then used this Marg EQ, which is something I use quite a lot. It's basically really good for adding air and like high frequencies to sounds. So I've done an incredibly harsh setting here because I think the original sound's quite low pass, so I sort of lost a lot of treble and then I was adding a lot back on, which is probably not the best way to do it, make a sound, but I just sort of liked where I got to with it, so I kept that. It's got this FabFilter Pro R reverb on it as well. And H-Delay, which is pretty much my favourite sort of tape delay style plugin. Just quarter notes. So. Then that's going into a compressor, which is side chaining from the kick. And then I've got a utility plugin on the out. I think quite often do this because I don't like to automate the levels in Ableton on the mixer because then you can't change the overall level. So as in like if this was being modulated, that would have to remain fixed. So I quite like to do any volume automation. I like to do it on separate plugins basically just to kind of keep things tidier. What I think is interesting about this sound is I basically changed the sort of the side chaining and the reverb on it as the track goes on. So on the second 16, so it starts off like this. I'll just play you a couple of bars. And then the second 16, it repeats. Sounds kind of weird and out of time without anything else there, but basically it repeats, but with either volume automation or a sidechain on it. I just need to remember how I actually did that. Basically just sounds a lot drier on the second repeat, and it kind of allows you to, you know, I normally wouldn't use such a sort of distinctive lead sound like that two sections in a row, but it sort of allows you to kind of repeat it without it sounding boring. Yeah, so the automation I did on this bass is up here in the mid-bass master channel. I've grouped all the mid-bass together. What I've done is use the draw tool to turn on and off this LFO tool, just doing this pattern. So another example of just using LFO tool to automate volume, basically. And it just allows me to kind of reuse the previous lead section in the second 16, but have it like tighter and basically just sort of like make sort of fades on the reverb to give it a different feel. Yeah, it's actually going massively out of time at the moment. I find that sometimes this happens in Ableton. It's a bit that you can have sort of plugins like LFO tool drifting out of time. So if that happens, I tend to render those sections basically. Not sure what's happening now. And then the rest of there's kind of a few like other bass layers that are less important that I've sort of grouped all together, I think, which are all in here. Try and play them now. I quite like this element. I'm trying to find out where it is. Is it here? there's one element I've sort of automated the LFO of a sound, and I've kind of had it just of one of the sort of mid-range bass sounds, and I've got it just like popping in here and there to do those kind of trills, like these bits. Yeah, this one here. So that's that channel's turning on and off like this, and you're just getting this little snatch of bass with an automated LFO. So yeah, don't know. There's lots of little bass layers basically here. Some of them are renders, like this one here, and some of them are still active, but they're kind of not really the main layers that you hear. It just adds a little bit of interest, I guess. Let's go through all of this. Right. So these are the lower bass layers that are the most obvious. So they're so there's a sub layer, and I'll just go into that quickly actually, just to show you that. Subs actually, weirdly, it's a triangle wave, but I normally, on this track I've basically used a triangle wave and then filtered it down just to give myself slightly more harmonics. So most of the time I'll just use a sine wave for the sub bass, but sometimes I'll use triangles or squares and then filter them down with a low pass afterwards, which just means that you just get slightly different harmonics. And if I want the sub to sound slightly warmer, those are the type of things I'd sort of go towards doing. And then I'd also sometimes I'll put saturation on it. This has got a saturator on it, but it's turned off. So yeah, a combination of, sort of saturation and low passing is a good way to add harmonics to sub bass, which can kind of make it sound a bit warmer. And then above that, I've got this, which is quite a sort of wide, mid-rangey sound. For this, I've used a combination of saw waves and then one of the digital oscillators in Serum. Basically done this to add a bit more bite to the, some of these, the wavetable oscillators are really good for doing that kind of thing. So just adding a bit more of a sort of crunchy top end to the, than you would get from a regular saw wave. And then you can sort of, this particular sound, you can sort of alter the tone of by moving the wavetable position, which is something, sometimes I'd automate that as well. I think I've used it, put it on sync as well, but I don't think that's actually doing anything. But that's also something I quite like to do to add harmonics to sounds. If I want to have like a very obvious strange harmonic, I might add that using the sync setting, which is one of the sort of settings in this menu in the oscillator and Serum. And then I've also got that on just the LFOs doing, it's just modulating a low pass on that on eighth notes. And I've used the compressor on a multiband setting and a slight EQ curve within Serum. The compressor on multiband sounds to me quite similar to OTT, which is the plugin we talked about earlier, which is just a kind of a multiband that's has quite a sort of extreme setting that a lot of people in dance music would use for these type of sounds. To sort of add presence, like exaggerate reverb tails, that type of thing. So those are the bass layers. I'll put them all together now just so you can hear them together. Boom, 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 boom I was really liked in this track, the sort of interplay between that, the bass and the lead. To sort of bring back a section of the lead that we danced. I've got quite into using markers in Ableton, which are quite cool. So you can basically just have like kind of cue points from different parts in the song. So I've got a few points that you can sort of jump to them, and it quantizes the jumps. Basically, just so you can like cycle through the song. And try out, you can sort of try out different sort of the way different structures sound on the fly if you set up a few of these and just flick between them, which is like a nice workflow thing. So drums next. I've got drums all grouped at the bottom. Now that you can, I really, really like the feature they introduced in Ableton 10 where you can group groups. So I tend to sort of like simplify tracks into big sort of subfolders, basically, so that all the drums are grouped together. Sometimes I'll group all the bass together. It does depend on, it depends on whether I'm like doing any effects to whole sections. So for example, in this, I've grouped the whole intro because I did that side chain on the intro. But generally I'll group them into sort of the main headline things. So drums, bass, leads, vocals, that type of thing. So the drums sound like this. The way I normally do drums is basically by layering hits together that I've previously used, and I kind of get these composite hits that I will sort of use in a few tracks and maybe change like the top end of them. So I'm kind of like always making new variations of like previous hits that I've used and that have worked well. So sometimes So there's lots of and then I kind of combine them all basically to kind of fill in the frequencies. So there's lots of different layers doing very similar patterns basically. So you've got like So this is a really old kick sample, actually. This is a good example of that. This is a super old kick sample I've used in those tracks. But in this case, it's only I'm only using it for the sort of top end of it. And then I'm layering that with another kick, which I'm using the whole sort of frequency spectrum of. So there's a lot of that type of thing, kind of filling in bits. There's a more sort of reverby feel to this snare, so I've used this, which is an 80s sort of snare sample that I had used on Time Warp, which is a really old track of mine, and I've basically used that as a reverb snare tail, and I've kind of got that layered with some other snares. So there's another one with a long tail. Then there's some sort of white noisy hats. This is sort of a loop of some like high-end from a, it's either breakbeat or like a drum plug-in like Addictive Drums. Sometimes I'll kind of make drum breaks within something like Addictive Drums, and then I tend to use them as sort of top layers. So basically, I always find in drum and bass there's a lot of high-end frequencies to fill out. So you always end up using a lot of layers, I find, that are sort of filling out your top end to add energy and to sort of add like a certain amount of like crunchiness to the beat. I always personally find that this is the sort of area that I need to work on when I'm working on a mixdown. So I'd initially not like normally add that in, and I sort of like will kind of come back to a track and sort of add more of that in afterwards to sort of basically just give more like top end information, more bite, and a bit more sort of texture in those areas. So there's loads of hi-hat layers, noise layers, that are basically all just like some patterns that I've chopped up in samples and copied out. I often like save loops from other tracks, basically. So these are some hi-hats that I used in Safe in Sound, which is a track on my second album. Then there's like this is some splashy stuff that we used when I did a remix or a track called Don't You Feel It that I made with, and I made the remix with 1991, and we made these sort of splashy sounds to go in that. So I quite often sort of save like loops of drums from other tracks, and then they'll get combined into newer songs. This particular track was slightly weird in the drum area because I had lots of drums from previous drops that I then grouped together and put into an auto pan, which is basically doing exactly the same thing as LFO tool on some of the other channels. It's just like chopping the volume really harshly. And I did this to basically make a sort of cymbally layer that's like more staccato, more chopped. So yeah, I mean, there's lots of, there's sort of hours of messing around with that, really, that type of thing. And then I've used a little bit of a breakbeat, I think, here to, hang on a sec, I'll just mute those for a second. Sort of flanged breakbeats from Splice, I think, there, just to, and that's for sort of fills. This drum roll I made from that's basically just a 909 sample that I liked that I then did like a pitch bend on going downwards, which is nice because you kind of get longer tails the further down you go. So that's kind of a nice trick for drum rolls sometimes. Yeah, more drum rolls. I've started to move to using more sort of like synth based drums recently, but for this one I was still sort of more based on samples, and I think both of them kind of have their place. They're just sort of like a different sound. There's some great tutorials for drum synthesis online that you can check out. I think Current Value is a really good guy to check for that, or I think Metric did one recently with you guys, which is well worth checking as well. Yeah, just trying to think of some bits that I haven't covered off. There's this quite cool piano sound I quite liked, which is like I think it's also quite Vangelis inspired. I think that's a Nexus piano. And through a huge shimmer reverb. I think I did some sort of reverse reverb stuff on that because it's rendered off here. What else have we got? I love this sound. It's something I made ages ago using the Roland Juno over there. Basically, on a lot of older synths have a kind of hold setting where you can press a note and it will hold for as long as that sort of voice is active until you press six notes, and then it runs out of notes and it has to start again. But it's quite a nice way to do pads if you have like quite slow attacks on them. Sometimes I'll make pads by doing that, so I'll sort of just trigger loads of notes. So it allows you to just play chords one by one note by one note, and then you could put loads of reverb on that. I think I then put that into a pull stretch afterwards, so it kind of created this sort of evolving sort of drone sort of sound. And you can sort of hear the notes like slowly coming in and out of and like some more, adding some more dissonant ones in. The reason the track's called Solar System is I originally had quite a corny sample from a sci-fi documentary in it about the solar system. And I ended up relegating that to just a tiny bit at the end, which I also made using Morphogene, which I really liked because it was like, basically, I was like,
we have traveled to the limits of our solar system, to the outer limits of our solar system.
I quite liked the way it sort of, I kind of mangled it within that. Again, basically, that'd be quite an easy thing to do within Simpler or Sampler or any sampler software. It's a really kind of powerful trick that I think not a lot of people do these days, because it's almost like quite old school, which is basically to just automate or move the start point of the playhead on a sampler, and it means you can sort of scrub through a sound in quite a weird, unnatural way, basically. I also really like to, that's something can be really powerful as well if you kind of combine that with the LFO plugins within Max for Live. So I really, really like these. They're basically you can, it sort of opens up Ableton to be used in a more kind of, in more of the type of way that you'd use like a Eurorack modular. So basically you could map this to the start point. So then you'd have an LFO moving at a certain rate, changing the start point. Which just means that you can LFO any setting of any plugin, basically, which is nice if you wanted to sort of, it's really good for sort of sound design things, and it's a nice technique to use, I find. I really like this sound. This is just, I think it's some of the intro ad-libs that I've just chopped a note from and then basically put into Fab Filter Saturn, which is a nice distortion. I really like this distortion for vocals, actually. And then put through a big reverb. Quite simple, but cool sound, I think. And then I've got this kind of trappy sounding ARP, but it's not the most exciting sound to talk about. It's basically just a Nexus Bell preset and then a sort of saw pluck from Silent that sort of layered up together. Just doing a sort of basic ARP. What else have we got to cover? So Master Chain. This track is slightly, this is kind of a bit of an anomaly now because I've started not using any Master Chain from sort of this point onwards pretty much. I quite like the just clipping stuff through Ableton as opposed to using any kind of compression or limiting on the master, because I find that there's not, the more sort of dynamics plugins you add in, the more artifacts you tend to get. sometimes think that you almost have to clip stuff nowadays because this is something I was talking to Noisia about ages ago. I don't know if they still sort of believe in this theory, but it's, I think we've kind of got used to hearing drums with a very, where the sort of the transient bit of it is always clipping kind of thing. So, but because it's such as, you know, even if you are creating some distortion there, it's such a momentary sound, you don't really register it as, you know, something that's audibly distorting. It's more just like something that grabs your ear more. So I don't really have a problem with clipping stuff or recording it too loud, unless it affects the dynamics of the song so much that it sort of sounds bad. But I think a certain amount of it is kind of to be embraced, and like a lot of people use that creatively to their advantage and have done for many years. A lot of older, like Dillinger stuff, for example, from sort of late 90s, early 2000s era, I remember hearing that a lot of that was sort of achieved by basically recording stuff super loud through DAT tapes. And, you know, like, I guess you get kind of different types of clipping in different media, and that has a different sound. So, but on this particular track, I was still using my kind of more older master chain, which is a preset that I made in T-Rex years ago. So it's basically a compressor followed by an EQ, which just sort of slightly lifts the tops and the low end, then a limiter, a multi-band limiter, and then a clipper at the end. What I used to do when I used to use T-Rex as an offline plugin, which is a real pain because the sound of this preset completely varies as to how loud you're going in on. So now I'm doing this all within the project. It's much easier. I just have like a utility before you go into it. But that's key to think of if you've got a master chain, is like how loud you run into that master chain, because that massively changes. You know, like one preset, if you have a preset that you use on all your songs, it's, you just need to be really mindful of the volume you're going in on. And then I've, on this particular one, I've got a K clip afterwards as well, so I'm clipping a bit again after the T-Rex is happening. But it's not doing a huge amount. I think it's just basically just compressing the whole track slightly, probably bringing the drums in a bit. If you take it off, breakdown sounds pretty similar. It's adding quite a bit of level, but it's not really doing huge amounts of dynamics. Maybe it's compressing everything a touch. This was my breakdown of my track solo system. I hope you find that interesting, and there's some like useful tips and stuff that you could use for your own music. This is Sub Focus signing out.